So today we look at what a business transformation is all about and how do you use TOGAF as a tool to do that. A little about myself. I've actually played the roles of a developer, analyst, architect, manager, director of technology, and currently an enterprise architect's role. So doing consulting and solutions on helping people move to the cloud, and also we are part of the open group member, which is consulting and training on TOGAF as well. So that's a little bit about myself, where I come from. So let us look at the broad scope of how enterprise architecture itself has evolved over the period of time. The initial version of TOGAF was more technology focused, and if you see at the bottom portion of it here, it's more about it solely concerned itself with how to use technology well and get things done. So over a period of time, the broad scope broadened, and it actually helped to combine all the architecture, the IT information technology architecture across the enterprise as a whole. So that's when all the SOA and all the IT optimization consolidation kind of things fell into place. And now if you do look at the TOGAF 9.1 version of it, it is actually there's a very strong influence of the business architecture, which is driving everything. So essentially, what we do in any company or organization is all about how do you make sure that technology is an enabler for the business that you do. So business architecture is very, very closely aligned with the rest of the architecture pieces, and that's what drives architecture as a whole. So technology is just an enabler. So that is the reason why the later day versions of TOGAF have more focus on combining these two entities, the business and the technology part of it, to make sure that you're driving value in the organization. So that's how the scope has broadened. So let us look at how we can use this tool effectively to solve our transformation problems in a company or in an enterprise. So as it is in any transformational journey in a company, we have something called the current architecture. So current architecture, your current state essentially. So just a minute. Yeah, yes. What I was referring to was basically there are multiple. The screen was not visible, so I'll just take you through what I was talking about. So the essential focus of TOGAF initially was only technical in nature. So you see at the bottom here, the scope is quite less. And then as we moved up in the later versions of TOGAF, it was about IT architecture across the enterprise, not in silos. So you're talking about all the divisions in your company and how they all tie together towards the mission and vision. So the later day, the current day flavor of TOGAF, which is 9.1, actually integrates both business and technology as a whole to solve your enterprise transformational problems. So let us look at how we can use this to actually go about doing transformations. So any company actually has a current state and a state that it desires itself to be in. So in between, there's a transition state. So let us look at what's involved in moving from one state to another. So initially, you have a set of goals that you want to achieve for your product or solution. Then you come out with a set of products and solutions which actually are aligned towards the goal. Then you have a set of data and application information workflows which actually the product or solution is trying to solve. Then you have some systems in place which actually the application sits on, and then that is actually leveraged and run on a premises using a technology stack composing of network, hardware, data centers and like. So once you have this, you now need to move to essentially your future state. So future state is something like, okay, you have an updated list of goals, like perhaps I want to increase my business footprint across multiple geographies, I want to make my application more scalable, I want to get more revenue from a certain region of customers. Then you offer a differentiated set of products and services to enable that. Then you come up with an improved set of data and information architectures to solve that. And then you also have the systems and applications which are re-engineered to make that happen. So you actually move from an as-is state to a to-be state. So in between, there is a certain amount of transition that's involved, and how you actually roll out the architecture from as-is to to-be is what TOGAF helps you to do at a very high level, elevator pitch level sort of a. If you had to sum up TOGAF in probably two lines, it would just to say that it helps you move from your as-is state to your to-be state, keeping agility and the cost of ownership less for everybody in the process. So what are the challenges in actually trying to move something? Because if you don't, your margins are getting lower, and then your license revenues are decreasing from your existing product lines, then your support costs are increasing even with offshoring, and then there are so many disruptions which are coming in the market, such as you know, BlackBerry, which was the leader in 2010, is no longer the market leader and is struggling to put the pieces together. And then you have the entire hotel industry which is being disrupted using Airbnb, and you have the taxi and transport divisions which are disrupted using Uber. So all of these are like moving the cheese out of existing players. So these days, change can happen in months, not in years. So you simply don't know who is taken away your magic or whatever. So then of course, any framework tells you about people, process, and technology to make things happen. So the people in your organization, let us say they are not connected to the organization vision. So how do you get them aligned? Then you also don't know how to bring about change in your organization. And then your products are not striking the right note with your customers. And then your organization has a learning, the learning coefficient in your organization is actually becoming a challenge. So an organization which learns well actually can respond better to changes. So let us see how TOGAF helps you to do all of this. So when you start any transformational program, you kind of list your existing portfolio, the list of applications in your portfolio, and then say that these are currently serving these kind of business roles. And you can actually grade them on a scale of 1 to 5 to say where they stand in terms of reliability, stability, and their ability to move itself into the cloud and so on. So, and then also you accord business value to it. So essentially you accord business value, and then you find that how it is actually, which application should be considered first, which should be considered next, and so on. So you accord, you can use a couple of value chain analysis, your Pareto principle kind of stuff. And then make sure that you're concentrating on something which is of high business value and obviously makes sense for you as a business unit to focus all your energies on those kind of applications and to re-engineer them instead of looking at the entire stack of what you really want to do. So this is what they famously call it as keeping your lights on. So the breadwinner applications in your company, which you need to, which is there in your kitty and you don't want to lose revenue from them. At the same time, you want to keep the customers with you and you don't want them to go to somebody else. So this is actually a challenge. It's like it's like trying to re-engineer a vehicle when it is moving fast. So what are the challenges? The challenges are essentially something which is a simple application over a period of time has now grown into an enterprise-grade application spanning multiple geographies, having various complexities like multi-byte, then multilingual, multi-entity, multi-tenant, and a whole lot of other challenges such as which comes with actually taking it across geographies. So that being the case, it's not a thing that it's not surprise that, you know, if a lot of applications actually look quite like big ball of mud or spaghetti architecture, because over a period of time they were all working in silos. But the current day necessities have made them that they need to be interoperable, they need to talk to each other with standards, and they need to be delivering on the organization mandate. So I recently visited a client whose architecture was, it doesn't almost look like this, which might be an exaggeration to say, but it almost resembled something which is all sticking to each other sort of stuff, and they wanted to move away from that to a clean, modular, scalable, service-oriented way of doing things. So over a period of time, any architecture can end up looking like that. So you identify what you want to do in your company. Like, let us say that first you decouple all of your architecture, make it stateless, try to move it to the cloud, and make it service-oriented. So all of these might be your mission and vision of what you want to do. And then obviously, no activity in your company can be done if you actually don't have the organization mandate or the senior management support from your company. So you have a vision, then you have the commitment from your senior management folks, and then you assess what is your readiness levels, and then you accord, you say that, okay, we are marching forward on our transformational journey. So that being the case, now the next question is, okay, why TOGAF? TOGAF is very helpful in moving from as-is to to-be state. It is used by the Fortune 50s of the world as a proven architecture practice because it brings in a lot of accountability into what you do as a framework, and it provides an assured return of investment while making technology decisions, people decisions, and process decisions. So it's like a proven framework. So you might as well harness the body of knowledge that it actually comes along with. And then what does it help you to do? It actually helps you to mix agility and architecture in a proper proportion to deliver value. So it helps you how you can actually create incremental architectures, how you can create incremental agile architectures and transition architectures. So instead of doing things big bang, which is the waterfall model, and it has failed. And then it's being used more so in digital and business transformations these days. Then it helps you to move from strategy to execution, from a 10,000 feet level to ground level on how you want to execute your architecture. Then it also helps you how you think differently as vis-a-vis a solution architect, and then how will you actually go from solutioning to your enterprise architecture, which is not just about your solution, but trying to look at multiple solutions across your domains. And then how do you do the interconnect of business and technology, which is actually been a big disconnect for a long time. And then companies which are able to make these two talk too well, I mean, they can drive business results much better than the ones who don't get this right. So lastly, it's also about separation of concerns or abstraction for an architect. So how do you actually think about abstraction, which is a key asset for an architect? So TOGAF helps you to compartmentalize various concerns into various categories, and we'll see how actually that's possible. So the next one is basically how TOGAF helps you to go from concept to cash. So right from strategy down, deep down to the way it's executed. So how does it help to do? Let us say that you have a very strategic initiative at the strategic level, 10,000 feet level. I want to do something. I want to connect people, like which is in a social media company's motto. Then you assess your capabilities, whether I have the requisite capability to do that, What are the skill sets required? What is the kind of business domain knowledge that I need to do this? Then you identify this capability across business, data, application, and technology stacks to see what your relevant capabilities are across in those domains for you to drive this strategy to execution part of it. Then you come up with a conceptual architecture around it, and then you put in the physical pieces and the logical and physical pieces to support the conceptual architecture. Then you roll out the product, support it, and then you finally get value. So at a very broad level, TOGAF helps you to do these steps as a part of its framework, so which we'll actually see how it is being done. But at a, if you had to abstract the whole TOGAF philosophy, then it would all, it can all be summed up in this one slide, which says this is what, this is exactly what it is trying to help an organization do. So at the core of TOGAF, it is more about, it actually uses a Deming cycle, which is basically nothing but plan, do, check, and act kind of a thing. So you plan, then you plan to do certain things, then you actually do it. After doing it, you go ahead and check what is the efficacy and measure how effective your what you've done was, and then you take actions upon it. So this is like a feedback cycle which continuously gets iterated upon n number of times till you get your product or solution which is of desired quality, and you keep on iterating it. So essentially TOGAF also similarly has something like that called the ADM. So what you're seeing now on the screen is essentially a picture of ADM, which is the framework of TOGAF. So it's the heart of TOGAF. So it has A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H steps that you see. And then it all starts with a preliminary phase, which gets initiated. And then you do your architecture visioning. You do your business architecture, data and information architecture, technology architecture. Then your phase E, you do your solution architecture. Phase F, you do the migration. G, you do your governance. And H, you make sure that everything is working as planned. So what this slide is trying to say is TOGAF resembles the Deming model of things, which is like it has continuous improvement at its core. So you keep on iterating this model till you match your requirements and your final solution. So your final solution meets the requirements, then you stop the iteration. So you continuously keep on adding value so that you improve your product and solution. So let us say that the old way of doing things was if you had to traditionally develop an architecture, let us say composing of an enterprise grade solution which composed of HR modules, payroll, ledger, payable, receivable, billings, assets, and treasury. So the previous way of doing things, which is the waterfall way of doing stuff, was you do your entire business architecture in the beginning, followed by the entire technical architecture, followed by your entire development and implementation. Then you go ahead and deploy it fully, sorry, you test it fully, then you deploy it. So this we all know actually is time consuming. And is quite a failed model because by the time the customer sees value, his requirements might have again changed. And so you're actually like standing in running water. So you can never stand in running water at the same place at the same time. So as opposed to this, TOGAF helps you to bring in the agility to it, agility flavor to it, which means that the same problem, if you were to do it using an agile framework, you essentially would iterate over all the pieces in smaller pieces of value and create incremental transition architectures as opposed to doing it big bang. So the heart of TOGAF is that it is agile in nature, it is iterative, and it helps you to create incremental value across the cycles as opposed to doing it big bang. So what you do essentially here in this case is you will actually do a little bit of everything in each of the phases. So you know, you'll do a little bit of your HR, then payroll, in the first iteration and develop a working solution for it, then you'll do couple of all of your modules in the next phase, and then you will provide an end-to-end working solution in each of your increments. So the customer sees a potentially shippable product, as opposed to doing all your design first, then finishing off with all your development next, and then finishing with all your. So you do pretty much everything simultaneously and get customer feedback much early in life. So that is the reason why it has agility at its core. So if you see the ADM of TOGAF, it is pretty much incremental and has agility at its core. So this is trying to drive this agile concept if you exactly deliver to your customer what he asked for in the beginning of the project, then you have completely failed. So this is what is the agile principle, and the ADM in TOGAF pretty much helps you to do exactly this, which is deliver incremental value over shorter iterations rather than one big bang approach. So if you have to sum up what TOGAF does in terms of delivering value on all of these architecture domains, so it actually has something called a strategic architecture, then a segment architecture, then a capability architecture. That's what you see now on this slide. And then it has various domains that business, data, application, and technology domains across which you incrementally add value. And then you have a time axis. So this is basically your roadmaps, your milestones, like how much of value are you going to be delivering in each of these domains in the specified time. And then you also have the level of depth, which is actually going from strategy to execution. So this depends on the maturity of the organization. Some people are so caught up in getting things done that at times they may not have a well-defined strategy in place. They might straight away jump to the solution architecture part of it. But essentially, the framework gives you all these things, all these levels of abstraction on how you can compartmentalize these concerns and address an enterprise product or solution problem. So this is an iteration between ADM. So ADM itself, we have not talked much about ADM. So I guess this slide would be slightly jumping ahead. But this is just to say that, let us say that you have not able to complete all of your activities in one iteration, that is from phase A to phase H, in which case you will actually spin off multiple such iterations to complete your architecture work. So this is to say that you will actually do multiple transition iterations in your ADM using TOGAF to complete your architecture work. So I mean, we can see this when we go about this in detail, but as of now, just remember that it is the whole framework is continuously iterated, and you are adding value piece by piece instead of doing everything big bang. And then this is basically trying to say how the framework helps you to manage from a portfolio level to a program or a project level down to a module or sub-project level. So you have a strategic plan, then you create a capability out of it, then you actually keep on adding capability increments to it, and then you create your deliverables or your building blocks, as they call it. So these days, everything pretty much is easily managed if it's a building block. So all the pieces that sit in your architecture can also be looked at building blocks, which means they are like Lego pieces. You can all arrange them and create a building of your desired nature. So there are a couple of phases that has been phase A does the visioning phase, B, C, D does the business, data, application, technology details in them, and then you go ahead and create your architecture and solution building blocks. So this is to say how you actually go from strategy to execution, finally go ahead and create your building blocks. But there are a lot of things involved in actually making this happen. And it can be seen once you actually deep dive into the framework itself. So how do you actually drill down the details? The example for that would be let us say that the company set out that we want one digital experience for our end user, and the broad level initiatives are omni-channel gateway, single sign-on for all users, and then at the portfolio level you break up those things into, we want to go ahead and create a canonical messaging structure, then we want to create a single sign-on which is all conforming to LDAP standards, and essentially create a common format. And then your UI for your for your tablets, phablets, Android devices and iPhones should all be should follow a similar framework. So if these are your portfolio level initiatives, then how do you sub-break them into your project level initiatives? So that would be basically you create subtasks of all these. That is, we want to port the existing users to LDAP. That would be your first step. Then you want to revamp your UI layer, decouple it from the business tier. Then you want to migrate all your profiles for the users into LDAP and so on. So basically you are breaking up your high level activities into projects or submodules so that you can incrementally deliver value to a customer in the turns using ADM, which is architecture development methodology, which is the heart of TOGAF. So that's the center of all of this, which you saw the faces A to H. So this is the heart of TOGAF, which actually helps you to do this breakup of strategy to execution. So essentially the preliminary stage is all about, okay, what pain points in my organization or solution or product should I pick up? Then what is that I want to accomplish as a result of that? And then I define my architecture around business, data, application, technology, and then I will create a solution around it and see what my opportunities are at that phase. Then I will create transition architectures, which helps you to move from your as-is to your to-be state. Then I'll execute the project. Then I will continuously monitor in my change management. Am I deriving value out of, what is my return on investment for the value that I've delivered? So this is essentially the framework which is extensively used. So this is essentially the heart of TOGAF. So everything in TOGAF revolves around this picture that is seen on the screen now. And it has multiple iterations in itself. So it has multiple sub iterations that go around it. So which is like you have multiple phases. The whole of your ADM itself is one iteration, but within one big iteration, there are multiple small iterations that you see in the diagram here. One is the architecture development iteration, which goes all the way from phase B to phase F. And then there's a transition planning iteration, which goes from phase E to F. Then there is a governance iteration, which actually pretty much happens between phase G and H. And there's a capability iteration that happens between phase A and the preliminary phase. So these are all the multiple iterations that happen in TOGAF that you can use based on where in the organization context that a company or decides to do its piece of work. And none of these steps are actually mandatory in the sense that none of these need to be executed in sequential order, which is what is the best part of the framework, because it is, let us say that in your current iteration, you don't have any business architecture work to do, or you don't have any data architecture work to do, you can skip that part and jump to the next phase. So this is an all-inclusive kind of a framework which gives you a guidance on how to do it, but you can pretty much customize it and tailor it according to your organization's need. So saying the same thing, at the phase, in the first iteration, you try to get an organization buy-in. Like before you start on doing something, the stakeholders should agree that they see value in what is being done. And then you create an architecture around it in your phase B, C, D, and then you actually make it work, create transition architectures, and then you keep it running. So this is what is done in each of these iteration phases, and it can be seen in more detail once we go to each of these steps. Now let us look at the next thing that TOGAF provides you. It actually creates, it has a set of tools and techniques which is helpful for any transformational project or change. So essentially it has something called the Architecture Development Methodology Guidelines and Techniques. So it has a set of guidelines and techniques how you should develop architecture, what are the best practices, what are the guidelines, how do you keep agility at its core, and so on. So the techniques and guidelines can be used for that. Then after you run through your architecture development method, you go ahead and create a repository which wherein you store in all the contents of these architecture artifacts that you create. So how do you create the library or the architecture content is governed by your architecture content framework. And then you go ahead and create all of that into your organization repository or your organization SharePoint, if you were to call it that way. So that's exactly what is your enterprise continuum, wherein actually you go ahead and store all your artifacts out of doing your architecture development method. Then essentially the last part would be you go ahead and create reference architecture models out of this, which are reusable in nature, and then you can pretty much harness the value of it as you go around the turns. So the last one is as an architecture unit, as a product or engineering unit, how will you actually go ahead and assess yourself in terms of architecture maturity, and in how good are you able to service your customers? What is your architecture maturity levels? Are you using the best practices? So this is similar to the CMMI that they use for QA kind of work for architecture. So it's called ACMMI, architecture related CMMI, wherein you grade yourself on a scale of 0 to 5, 5 being optimized, 0 being unstructured, and 1 being managed, and 2 being slightly better than that, and so on. So this is what the architecture actually helps you to do. This is what TOGAF actually brings to the table in terms of the value that it provides to helping organization move towards transformation stages. So given this background, the next thing to do would be, okay, from your organization kitty, you pick up a pain point that you want to go ahead and solve, and then make that your mission statement or your life's main objective. So as Swami Vivekananda said, that any idea or thought, you can, unless you live the idea, sleep the idea, and walk the idea, you will not be able to make it. So you need very strong commitment for your idea to work. So let us say that you are a banking company, and you are at crossroads on how to modularize your software so that even the small time banks also start using your software. The previous world view was, you sell me a part of your banking solution. These days there are small time banks which say that, okay, we don't need all your mammoth flavors of your software. We just need piecemeal of your stuff. So can you host it in the cloud and using a software as a service model? Provide it to me so that I can reach more the unbanked customers. Let us say that this is a challenge that company banking software provider is coming. So if that is the case, then let us say the mandate before you start off your TOGAF for transformation is that you want to bring the unbanked into the banking sector. So let us say this is your executive vision. So you want to tap the rural banking and the microfinance segment so that you can get you can increase your penetration and more people start using your software. So if this is your mandate, what are the drivers for this? TOGAF gives you a guideline on how actually you should create these drivers, objectives to meet this kind of a vision statement. So there is a big guideline on how you actually can go ahead and create drivers, objectives, goals. So all of these actually tie to the changes that you actually go ahead and do. So let us say that the initiative is a Simply Bank, and it has a set of business objectives, which is like getting the unbanked people into the banking, lower your cost of operations, making banking solutions available to small players. You want to modularize your business process so that you can host it on the cloud, and probably create a software as a service model around it. And then let us say that this, once you have the set of business objectives, StoGraph tells you how to break this business objectives into IT objectives, and then how this IT objectives actually drives your business architecture decisions, data architecture decisions, application architecture decisions, and technology architecture decisions. So you actually can go ahead and create decoupled services as the next step. You can modularize your IT. You can actually take steps to move into the cloud, and then you can do all the software as a service kind of initiatives in your company. So once the vision is set, you create a set of goals, drivers, objectives for it, and the objectives we saw actually can be broken from strategy to business to the technical details on how you want to tie them up. So the vision as such can be influenced from internal forces, and also you can have external bodies such as regulatory bodies which can influence your vision. So you just mind map those also, so that when they come at a later point of time, you are not taken by surprise that we have work to do when the regulatory bodies come up with their requirements. So having done this, the next step would be, how do you actually compartmentalize? You're delivering, let us say, the modularized pieces such as lending, savings, schemes, offers, and subsidy, which is a broad part of what you want to roll out as a part of your bringing the unbanked into the banking arena. So if you were to see cross-cutting concerns, you have Aadhaar, which in India is similar to your social security number that you see in the States. So that's a horizontal cross-cutting concern that actually runs through a vertical partitioning of the architectures. So you actually have deep down the operations management, which actually helps out. So you have a set of vertical concerns and you have a set of horizontal concerns. So the horizontal concerns are actually cutting across all the domains that you're trying to address. So what happens when you actually have a microfinance solution that you're trying to offer? You also have to take into account what is the influence of the regulatory bodies on your solution. So you have local bodies, your schemes, microfinance, government NGO, and subsidies. So these are all going to be influencing a solution. So you actually create solutions around them also, so that you factor those challenges when you actually roll out the pieces, because you're looking at things from an enterprise level, and these are pretty much things that you'll encounter, and StoGraph has standards on how you should actually go ahead and address these kind of needs also. So there is a very strong framework in StoGraph which helps you to create business principles, how you can actually go ahead and create a business principle. And then it tells you what is the rationale of doing such a principle and what are the implications of not doing it or not having a principle in the first place. So there's a very strong guidance on how you can go ahead and create business principles for your organization unit to cater to, so that all of them, when they design, develop solutions, it all actually meets the business principles behind it. So there is a very strong emphasis on how to create business principles. And then you go ahead and create an organization-wide taxonomy and metaphor around it. So StoGraph has a very rich knowledge base on how you can create a taxonomy for the architecture work that's being done. Because let us say that you're having a scheme called daily deposit scheme in your unit, and perhaps you might abbreviate it to DDS. But DDS for the outside world may mean several other things, or it may mean something completely different. So unless you create a taxonomy for what you're doing and explain it very clearly to your end audience, you may even convey the wrong message to the development team or the QA team who might be looking at these assets and developing solutions even internally. So the challenges of getting this misinterpreted externally is even more. So it helps you to create a very strong taxonomy and metaphor around what you're trying to develop. So having done that, there is a strong guidance on how you can actually improve your capabilities across your people dimensions, process dimensions, and material dimensions in terms of the framework. If you have to roll out this solution, what kind of development skills do I need, and what kind of certifications or what kind of development skills my people are required to have, what kind of process maturity my team should follow, what kind of framework they need to be updating, what kind of code or check-in, check-outs, deployment standards and continuous integration methods they need to follow, and what are the different kinds of material, what kind of technology stack are they going to be using, how much of open source, how much of enterprise software, and in what combination will I use this. So all of this gets actually detailed in the business capability identification on how you're going to achieve your business capability in what increments. So we saw, then next comes your conceptual vision. So in the interest of time, let us not dwell too much into this. So it's just to say that this is a 20,000 feet of what you want to achieve. So you actually put them all into a block diagram saying that these are the things I'm looking at a 10,000 feet level. And these are my services, this is my banking features, this is my functional features, and so on. So you've conceptualized that, then you create a workflow around how you want to achieve these different pieces talking to each other. And then you actually abstract them into services, then you create an application architecture around it, and so on. So then you go ahead and create a deployment diagram based on how actually you want to roll these out to the end users. So, and then finally at the end of doing all of the ADM, you are left with a lot of artifacts which are pretty much reusable in nature if you have architected it in that manner. So which you can go ahead and store in your enterprise continuum. So TOGAF calls something called enterprise continuum, which means it is actually like a classification for your organization SharePoint, where you can actually store resources into your organization and actually get value out of the framework. So the more you go towards the right side of this picture, it is how specific you can get to architectures. And the more you go to the left side, it is about blue sky thinking on how you can create generic architectures. So an organization generally on day one will have a generic architecture, but over a period of time, 1 or 2 years down the line, they'll have specific architectures. So this kind of gives you a guideline on how to actually manage your architecture artifacts and how to store them incrementally in your organization. So it has multiple catalogs, deliverables, building blocks, and matrices and diagrams. TOGAF actually has a lot of guidance on how you can actually go ahead and create these kind of artifacts. One is the architecture definition document. So it has a very strong guidelines on how you can actually use something called a business scenarios kind of technique to actually create and define your architecture so that it's unambiguous to your end users. So the next is how do you actually go ahead and create your architecture principles, so to define and create your architecture work. The next one would be how do you go ahead and create your vision itself. There's a lot of detail on how you actually create vision and principles around it so that people it doesn't end up looking like a vague thing for people to do. So it's actually a working work in progress kind of a statement. And then how do you go ahead and create your business scenarios technique for your architecture, which is actually making sure that the business and technology guys talk to each other, and then how will you document these so that it's unambiguous to the end users. So then it has various catalogs. I've just taken seven. It's around 56 different catalogs on how you can create and define your architecture pieces work. I've just taken 7 or 8 of them just to illustrate what is all there in the framework for people to use and harness. So next is how you can actually create, how the request for architecture work itself can be made by your stakeholders. So there is very strong guidelines on how that can be done. Then the statement of architecture work, when the work is handed over to the architecture team, how can that be done? So that's also something done. And this apart, TOGAF has a lot of tools for decision making, which is the analysis tools. And it has a planning tool, It has a decision making tool. It has a design tool. There are a lot of design tools on the business, data, application, technology architectures on how you can go ahead and create architecture reference patterns, architecture reference models, and so on. And then it has got a change management tool. How do you handle change management in your company? It also has got a strong governance tool on how you can actually govern and manage your architecture on a day-to-day basis. So it also has an alignment tool wherein all your decisions in your enterprise are strongly managed by the enterprise architecture function, which makes sure that the business and the operating models, they both talk to each other and have a lot of synergy, and the disconnects are avoided. So it has a lot of these best practices which multiple companies have used, and a lot of Fortune 50 and 500 companies uses extensively. So that is the promise of the framework. So when you start, go ahead and change. So I think I've reached a logical conclusion on this on the webinar. So the next would be, I think, since we are limited by time to keep it for 1 hour, so let us stick to the time, and let us take questions on the chat window. So if you have questions, we'll actually take questions on the chat window, and we can have people post their questions on the chat window, or they can mail also at webinars@knowledgehut.com. In which case we will have it answered offline. But if there are any, I'll actually wait now for the next 5 minutes. People on the call can actually pose questions on the chat window. Thank you. Thanks for listening.